local recording. Okay, here we go. We're recording. It's time. It's time. It's time. Let's blow that up because I can't see it. Okay. Here we go. The beginning of the beginning happens now in 3, 2, 1. Coming up on TMS, Batman killed me.
Nerdtacular tickets tomorrow.
What's Calista Flockhart doing?
Tomato trackers.
John Traavolta goofed.
Snipes, Endgame.
Fitness geek.
Jury duty.
Your calls and more on this episode of The Morning Stream.
There are demons and there are evil people in the world, and you post a picture like that and some cultist gets hold of it, a coven, and they begin muttering curses against an unborn child. I just don't think that this business of, I mean, posting the most intimate parts of your body on Facebook, I just can't see it. It to me is abhorrent, but it isn't necessarily unbiblical. It's just abhorrent. All right?
And maybe unwise, as you said. You need to think that
you
through.
Never can, you tell know what somebody's going to do. Yeah. All right.
Oh, they're still chasing me. Wah!
The Morning Stream. The Morning Stream. The Morning Stream.
This is The Morning Stream, where you get to be the man.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to The Morning Stream. TMS for Tuesday, February 24th, 2015. That marks an important day on your calendar. It's either the day before Nerdtacular tickets go on sale, or the day before you can get a discount if you buy it now before they release the Homeworld Remastered Collection on Steam, or it's the day before. I don't have a third one. Is there a third one?
Day before the 25th.
Thank you. I appreciate that. It's me. It's Brian. Hi, Brian. What's going on?
Well, not much, man. How you doing?
I got a cold, so we're gonna see how I feel as we move on here. I'm fine. Everything's fine. We're all fine here. How are you?
You're not just going to suddenly, I can't do the show. I'm going to go lie down.
No, it's not that kind of, so it's not like I should be happy I've dodged the flu bullet this year, at least so far. I should probably knock on wood because, there you go, this is actual wood. Because, you know, it's still flu season. We're still in the middle of it, but I have not had, it just sucks because yesterday I thought I was maybe coming down with it and I wasn't sure. But it's the first cold since April of 2013, and that was a strep thing, so it was even worse than a cold. But the first time, you know, I've had a head, chest, and whatever for 2 years almost.
Wow.
I was enjoying that record. It was great. I don't think I've ever had that record. It's usually once or twice a year I get some kind of cough or throat thing or chesty thing or something. But I've, you know, good eating and regular exercise and the weight loss and washing hands all the time and never touch your face. Those things all contribute to a healthy thing.
That's what they say. And you got to look back. What did I do? What did I do?
Yeah, I probably touched my face. Because you know that's how you do it. You shake somebody's dirty old hand and then you rub your eye once and you're done. That's it.
Right. All you got to do is get that finger close to the eye. The little germs go, oh, look, an entry.
An
opening. What's going here?
Yep. They rush in like a Walgreens sale the day before or the day after Thanksgiving. Just a big crowd of germs just rushing the door so they can get a good deal on that weird vibrator they sell
this
there.
This looks warm. Well, this looks inviting. Let's go in here.
Exactly. Anyway, I'm glad to be here. You're glad to be here. Let's go ahead and be here, I guess.
Okay. All right.
So we've got a couple things to talk about up top. One, though, is this. I couldn't deny putting this in the top of the show because it just struck me as too funny. And I always think about, you know, when you die, what do you want to have in your obituary? Do you write your own?
Sure.
Does somebody else write it? Like, do you have a plan for that? Do you want to do your own? Do you want to be creative with it? Are you just going to let somebody else do it? Like, what do you think?
I hadn't really thought about it, but I would like somebody else to write it.
I mean, hopefully it's a ways off, right? Like, we're talking.
I'm hoping, yeah.
Double where we are
at
now.
At least until the end of this show.
Right. Right. I've got Kim
Lord,
and Tina.
Get me through this episode of TMS.
Yeah. Lest I have a poorly, hastily written obituary on the other side. Some people like to get jokey with their obits.
Yeah, I think I would too. I think now that you're putting this thought into my head, I think I'm going to eBay auction the rights to write my obituary.
Well, that's a funny. You know that would make. That would go viral if you did that.
It probably would go viral. Yeah. It'd be like, you know, get the ability, get free rein on whatever you want to write about, mm-hmm. about Brian Ibbett for his obituary.
It's funny. I often think that the most viral or the most viral thing I'll ever do probably mm-hmm. will be something that happens in death. And I don't know what that is yet. So let's think hard and long about that because, you know, we can't ever, if I can't ever get a comic to 1 billion views, mm-hmm. maybe my way to do it is.
Is through some sort of viral...
Or he drew this after he died, or, you know, something weird like right. that.
You know, as long as Leo Laporte does not get to contribute to the eBay auction, he does not get to bid on the eBay auction.
Yeah, he's restricted.
Well, Brian Ibbotson passed away. This obituary brought to you by Drobo.
Drobo. I forgot about the Ibbotson. I guess I got to play it now. Hold on. Brian Ibbotson.
Brian Ibbotson.
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 I love it. And he was hanging out and talking to you that day. That's the best part. Anyway, by the way, go back and look at the photos from that year in Vegas. I am a fatty. I am such a fatty that year. Total fatty. Anyway, that was before all the weight loss. Oh. So here's the deal. This obituary was found. Where the person who died claims to have been killed by an uppercut from Batman.
Nice.
Yeah, so here I'll read the bits from it here. According to an obituary in a local Florida paper, a comic book fan named Stephen Merrill died the way he lived. The obit lists the cause of death as an uppercut from Batman. Family and friends published the obituary on the Ledger, a local paper from the Lakeland, Florida area last week.
That's where Andrew Allen lives.
Oh, is it? That's cool. He's still with us, right? He didn't write this weird obituary. He's still around. He's still around. Okay.
He composed it on a piano and played it in five-part harmony.
Good. Anyway, died suddenly on February 12th at the age of only 31. That's very young. No cause of death was listed, but he'd been fighting cancer since 2013, so there's some thinking about that. But anyway, it was a comic book worthy death as a joke, and it caught on. People have been spreading it all over the place. It went like this. He would have been honored to have died by an uppercut from Batman, said the deceased fiance, Stephanie Vella. A close friend added, it was worth it for the family. It was the only time the family was able to laugh in days. We are all laughing. It made the situation easier to deal with. So, I guess what I'm getting to here is, some would say that if you put something kind of goofy in your obituary, that it doesn't show respect that your life deserved, or perhaps... The you've besmirched the memory of your time here on this planet, but I say, be as goofy as you freaking want to be.
Right. Well, it depends on the person. I'm trying to think of a good example of like somebody who this would not be appropriate for. Right. Some you know prestigious.
Like a world leader or somebody.
The guy, right. The guy, the weird looking dude who does the Westminster Dog Show.
Oh.
Would be inappropriate.
Yeah, that's a good one. Well, only because he's so uptight, and exactly. you know what I mean. Like it's only inappropriate because that's the personality of the guy. So it should match whatever the personality is. In other words, I don't want somebody swooping in and saying, "Oh, Tom Brokaw died."
Right.
His fart smelled like chicken. You know, like you can't do that.
Kevin Smith, though, you could say Kevin Smith died. Scaling a wall and slipped on a banana peel.
Exactly.
Or something like that,
so appropriate know. To the life lived is what you're
correct.
Getting at. Okay.
Correct. Or all the right. personality of the life lived.
I think there's a lesson in there about other stuff too. I like where your head's at with that. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, we've learned a little something there, everybody. And Batman is a bad
Curtis
man.
Curtis B says, "Here lies Gandhi, killed by an uppercut from Batman."
Here's the funny thing, though. Now that I think about it. This is bad for Batman, because Batman doesn't kill his foes.
Yeah, that actually is funny, because when you were first reading that first line, I was thinking, oh man, DC might have an issue with this.
Mm-hmm. And Bruce Wayne would have an issue with it. Like in fact, some would say, well, is he a true comic book fan? Because he would know, this guy would know, that Batman never kills his victims.
Right.
Not his victims, his, what would you call him? His,
adversaries.
Adversaries, thank you, perfect.
Sure. Sure.
Nicely done. All right. So
in the middle of a great Gotham episode where they're getting ready. From what I hear, they're getting ready to introduce the Joker, but they've got this blind fortune teller.
And I wonder if it's is that supposed to be him?
No. That's a different character. But I want to say this blind fortune teller is something from the comics, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's similar to, was it Oracle? Wasn't Oracle? No, Oracle wasn't blind. Mm. I know, and I know Oracle was a she, and I know, what wasn't she Commissioner Gordon's daughter or something? Or am I thinking of?
No, that's Barbara Gordon, and she ended up being. Was she blind?
She was Batgirl. No, I guess it was one of the other.
Oh, she broke her back.
Prey.
Though. Yeah, she broke her back though later.
Right.
That's what happened. Because remember, she broke her back, and then she ended up sitting in a wheelchair, calling the shots from the cave for a long time. Yeah.
Yep.
I was going to say something else about that. No, I forgot. Crap. Oh, the Gotham show. I haven't seen Gotham at all, not once. And so, let me know when Crazy Quilt comes on the screen, and then
sure,
I'm
I'll,
in.
I'll keep you posted.
Okay,
Crazy Quilt,
greatest villain of all time, Crazy Quilt. It's so stupid. It is the dumbest thing. I know Marvel's got their share of dumb characters. Everybody's got their crappy characters, but Crazy Quilt. I know Matter Eater Lad's pretty bad.
Yeah. Oh well, at least the worst name of a character, and Marvel's had it too.
Yeah.
What was it? Night Nurse or I still can't get past Scarlet Spider.
Yeah.
Dude running around in a hoodie.
Yeah, that's dumb. There's a lot of dumbness happening in comics. But nonetheless and notwithstanding, tomorrow is Nerdtacular ticket sale day.
Woo!
Woohoo, everybody. if you want to get your Nerdtacular tickets, many of you have signed up on the mailing list to be told when they go live, which we will do. You've been doing that over at Nerdtacular.com, the newly redesigned site. And tomorrow, tickets go on sale. Looks like we had said 9 a.m. Mountain Time Zone. So when this show starts tomorrow, tickets will be on sale.
Wow.
You'll be able to get them. And all the other information about the event, at least that we have so far, will be up there in terms of where it's at, when, how to get your reservations, all that stuff. The only thing we don't have up there yet is the full schedule. That's being worked on right now. Also, Brian's got a band brewing for Music Act. Mm-hmm. We got all kinds of announcements coming, and they'll come shortly.
Yes.
But for those who want to get on the wagon early, tomorrow's your day. So watch for that. All right. I guess that's all I have for that, Brian.
Okay. All right.
Something happened this morning that made me want to tell you about it. And I've learned more and more that because I have so many things going on, If you don't write it down, I lose it, and it really bothers me because some of my best like 2 a.m. comic ideas, I'll lay there and I'm so freaking tired, I'll go, oh, that's a great idea.
Right.
I'll just remember
I'll
it.
Make sure. I'm sure I'll remember that tomorrow morning. Yeah, that won't be a problem.
Because it's so good, I'll remember it. And then I'll wake up at 8 and go, what the hell
was that idea?
What
was I supposed to remember? Yeah, oh, that sucks.
And it's so frustrating. So this morning I had this great thought. Totally was going to share it with you.
Mm-hmm.
Fell right out of my collective.
Are we going to dress up as Left and Right Shark for Nerdtacular?
Oh my gosh, dude. How great would that be?
That would be great. That should be our cosplay.
You think that meme will still mean something then?
Probably won't, actually. People will be so sick of Left Shark.
Yeah, Left Shark, dude. That guy's great. Did you ever see the guy that was in there, though? Muscly man shark
guy?
Yeah, oh my gosh.
Like the...
I expected some schlubby dude in there that got $5 and a pound of Coke or something, but he is like this big buff like dancer guy. That was awesome.
I imagine that she probably uses him for like dances where they've got to carry her on a little Egyptian pedestal and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah,
part of her regular dance troupe.
Probably shoots fireworks at him with her boobs. Who knows? Dump a Trek Nerd brought to you by.
I'm just picturing, like, you know, he goes from being an Egyptian slave carrying Katy Perry around to, you're going to be wearing the big blue and white cloth shark suit.
Yeah, you'll be on the left, buddy.
Good luck with that.
Yeah.
Hey, are you a fan of science fiction?
Yes.
Of course you are. Check out the Kickstarter for the novel Fabricated Dreams by fellow Tadpooler J.M. Dudley. When her father is murdered, Fina must return to the virtual reality he created and find his killer before the killer finds her. It's got action, adventure, cyborgs, flying cats. Even better, the novel is finished and you can get the ebook for as little as $5. To read the first chapter or support the novel, search Fabricated Dreams on Kickstarter today.
All right, Daryl, are you there?
Yes, hello.
Ah, good morning. How are you?
I'm good.
Good. We called you early so you could hear our banter a little bit more today.
Oh, that was fun.
Yeah, I'm glad you enjoyed that. It's a little bonus. It's part of just the wonderful way that you get to work with the Frog Pants family every morning. Beep, 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 beep. Daryl, it's time for Stump a Trek Nerd. You're the Trek Nerd. You come on the show, you answer hard trivia about Star Trek, and we have a little fun while we're at it. Are you ready for your thing? Are you ready?
We'll soon see.
Brian, I think you switched.
I did, reads. Yeah. I was just writing.
Awesome. As long as we get them on the other one, it doesn't matter.
Exactly. Totally. See my fine. Note there?
Oh, yeah, there it is.
I scrolled down too far.
I looked at it and went, oh, that. All right, let's do it. Here we go. Daryl, here you go. In the Next Generation episode of The Offspring, Data creates an android named Lol.
Oh.
He did it for the lols. At first, Lol was genderless and only had a simple humanoid form. Data gave Lol a choice of what species to appear as. Which one of these was not one of the choices Data presented to Lol? So this is one of the options not presented. Was it A, human? B, Androidian. the Andorians. C, Klingon, or D, Vulcan. Human, Andorian, Klingon, or Vulcan were the options, or one of those options was not presented to Lol as an option to be. I think it became a girl, but I don't remember the rest. Anyway.
Yeah, that was a stupid episode.
Yeah, I remember it being high-minded, but badly done, right. Executed is the word I meant.
Why can't I have an offspring?
Yeah, I'd like to have. I'm fully functional.
Experience the joy of raising a child.
all right, think about that one real hard, okay? I want you to think real hard while I click a thing that's eluding me for a minute. Why? Okay, there we go.
Are you hungry?
Aren't you hungry?
Watch a foodie.
It's Scott and Daryl Day, because you and I are the only person with things left. We got a box that, for some reason, Brian didn't get. I don't know why, but...
I'm so sad, because it looks so awesome from the way you describe it.
Says Andrew Muddy, Muty. Muty or Muddy, do you think? I don't know.
If it's M-U-T-T-I, I would say Muty.
Muty. Muti. Yeah.
Muti.
You are Muti. He says, Dear Scott, I wanted to thank you and the Frog Pants crew for all the great content that you put out. I listen to lots of your shows and feel like you guys keep me connected to American culture where I live here in Japan. The 5 wooden bookmarks are for the Johnson family, made by me from black walnut and Japanese cherry. Ooh, that's amazing. All right. Oh, can I just say, can I make a quick recommendation since we're in a science fiction segment of the show here? Man in the High Castle, the pilot that's on Amazon that just got picked up for a full season. Holy poo, that's going to be good. It's really good. That pilot, I mean, Tom was singing its praises. Schwood was telling me I had to watch it. I knew it was a Philip K. Dick thing. I barely knew what the story arc was. It is so freaking good so far. And it's just one episode up on Amazon right now. But the whole thing got approved for a full season. It was part of their pilot program. I cannot wait for that series to hit.
Wow.
Oh my gosh, you guys. I can't even... It may be my most excited TV thing coming, period. It stuck with me like crazy. I can't stop thinking about
it. What's it called, man?
Man in the High Tower. Or High in the Castle. Sorry, Man in the High Castle. Sorry. Castle, not Tower.
I have not even heard of this thing.
Yeah. You need to. It's rad. And it was just part of their pilot thing. And it was the most watched pilot of everything they had, which deservedly so. It's an alternate history thing set in 1963, I think. Mm. Where the Nazis won and Japan won. Wow. They bombed us first. And the country's divided. Japan controls the West Coast. There's a neutral zone in the middle. The Nazis control the other half. Actually, they kind of control it all. There's a big conflict between the Nazis and Japan. It's about the resistance there. And then there's some sci-fi twist stuff I don't want to give away. But my gosh, totally, totally hooked on this thing. Imagine all the Star Trek episodes where they go back to like Nazi-themed planet.
Yeah.
But imagine that being good.
But it being good, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really fantastic. I cannot say enough about it. Anyway, you should watch it, Brian.
Why am I getting a promo? I'm looking for it, and I'm getting a promo of something with a with Rachel Dratch, and I don't think that's it.
No, they do. Well, that's weird. I mean,
it's like a promo for Amazon original.
Oh, they have a commercial at the top of it for some reason. Yeah. All the pilots do. That's how I think they help offset the cost. Tom and I were talking about this on Friday, but yeah, then it's uninterrupted the rest of it.
Gotcha.
Awesome, okay. Awesome. So there's another one in there, Mad Dogs, also good. But I cannot say, and they both got picked up, but I cannot say enough about Man in the High Castle. I don't know what I was expecting. I got something totally different. I love the feel of it. I'm in, all in, all the time.
Kind of, yeah, this sounds really cool.
Yeah, oh my gosh. Anyway, Hitler's an old man in it, dude. Hitler is an old man.
Oh, man, Hitler.
He lived.
Oh, there we go. Now it looks like it's getting to that. Okay.
According to the buzz, reading stuff about the book, this isn't in the show yet anyway, but Eisenhower was like assassinated. I was like, all this great stuff. Oh, my gosh.
Wow. Yeah, this has a really cool looking feel to it.
Yeah.
All right.
And they play this creepy version of Edelweiss in the opening credits with this like weird graphic of what the country looks like now that it's taken over by Nazis. It's just cool. Alternate history stuff is so much
fun.
And
it's confirmed that it's getting picked up?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Cool.
Announced it last week, so could not be happier about it. Anyway, Daryl, let's eat.
Yeah. I don't know where that thing is. What are we eating?
Oh, did you not have the bar? Yeah, it was the one with the Japanese Kit Kats and stuff. Remember you and I got
and
he didn't?
I've got so much of that.
So, let's
rub it in.
Let's do a Kit Kat. I mean, these are great because these don't even have English on them at all. So there's
a black one and a red one.
Yeah, let's do the black one. And we don't know what's in this except it's a Kit Kat.
In the meantime, I'll be enjoying beef jerky sent to us by Marlissa from Atlanta.
Aww.
Which actually I'm excited to have.
All right. I never got that, so enjoy that. Mm. All right, we're going to open this up. Looks like dark chocolate is my guess. Because it's a little dark. Ooh, these are tiny. They're like the beds in Tokyo. Look at that.
Oh, on the back there's a bird with a speech bubble and it's not saying anything.
Yeah, that's weird. So look, you guys, it's about a third shorter than usual Kit Kats.
Make your own caption for the bird.
Mm-hmm. They love those little party games over there. All right, I'm just going to eat it. I don't know what's in it.
Oh, yeah, it does look like dark chocolate and it smells like it.
Oh, they're great. They're so much better than here.
Ooh,
It's not waxy.
This is spicy.
Is it?
Mm-hmm.
You got water handy?
I have coffee handy.
All right, once again, proof Japan knows how to make those Kit Kats, dude.
Yeah, that's good.
I think one of these, they've got something called Black Thunder in here, which you were talking about yesterday, I think.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's like a Twix, so we'll save that for tomorrow. Ooh, yummy. All right. Thanks, Mutie. And we don't know where. Maybe Brian's is in his P.O. box. He's going to check. But
so I was going to say, I'm going to check the P.O. box after the show today.
And is that something you can. You have to go there to see, right? You can't. Mm-hmm. There's no camera in your box or something cool like that.
No. That'd be cool, though. I think if I paid enough, they probably would do that for me.
That'd be all right. A little battery operated thing.
I'd pay to have them go check my box and say, yeah, you got something with some Japanese writing on it.
Yeah. I have to go in once a year to get my box checked. Anyway, all right, Daryl, let's move on. Heyo. Why don't we talk about this birthday you have prepared? Who had one?
Well, that would be Fred Steiner. He would have been 92 today. He passed away in 2011 at age 88. He composed the musical scores for TOS, the motion picture, and TNG.
Wow. So here's a question for you. We've been doing this show long enough, 3+ years for your segment, right? How many of the birthdays are we just annualizing? Like, have we done this guy before? Do you know?
Oh, we probably have. We've gone through these so many times. I think some of them are repeated, yeah. But if I notice that we're repeating them, then I try to do somebody else.
Yeah. Cause I know we do big names every time, right?
Like, yeah, exactly. Like if it's, Spiner or Frakes or Shatner or Nimoy or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Even
yeah.
if we've done that one before, we're going to do it again.
Yeah, or Goldsmith or whoever. We got to do the big ones.
Right. If it's Larry Finkelstein who played crewman number 7.
Oh. Yeah. Well, if at some point we run out of birthdays, if we run out of birthdays, listeners, why don't you send in your ideas of what other weird Star Trek thing can Daryl dig up that's like a birthday? Like, who?
Like on this day, the episode Trouble with Tribbles first aired.
Yeah, that kind of stuff is
there's
cool.
There's lots of stuff like that.
We should do that. Actually, you know what? Executive decision. Let's do that. These people are going to have their birthdays or not.
Or are we doing that?
I think you can combine them. Like, let's see how it goes. I just really like that kind of trivia.
Right.
Yeah, this day in Trek history is kind of a cool idea. All right, okay. Daryl, let's get back to your damn question. It's this Next Generation episode. Data offered to give his maid robot a nationality or a race, I guess. It's either human or one. And he said one. He said all of these but one. Human, Andorian, Klingon, or Vulcan. Which one of those did not make the list?
Well, it shows human, but maybe that wasn't on the list. I'm pretty sure the Andorian and Klingon were choices. Maybe he didn't want it to be emotionless, because that what's the point of having an emotionless robot?
Right. Well, aren't this... But the thing with the... Yeah, because he's always fighting against that, right? Like, he wants to have emotions. But also, aren't Klingons just... Or, sorry, Vulcans just good at suppressing them? They don't necessarily not have them. They just are extremely, perhaps, evolutionarily skilled at blocking them, right?
Yeah.
Because they have their puberty thing, and they do their whatever.
Far and right, right.
Yeah. I always forget that name, and then Brian always remembers it. I never remember Ponfar, and if I bring up the puberty thing, Brian always knows it's Ponfar. I don't know why
That's
I can't remember.
That's why I'm so good at the trivia, Scott.
That's right. Don't mess with Brian. He'll win a giant check before you know it. Those huge checks. All right, so what do you say there, Daryl?
So, Vulcan, they suppress their emotions kind of the same way that you don't swear every third word.
Yeah. Me specifically, might. You mean?
Yeah.
Oh. Well, depends on the swear.
Well, word. I guess more I'm talking... Well, never mind. Well,
I am not an F-bomb dropper. I'm just not. I find it caustic. I usually don't say the bitch word either very often, because I feel like it's... when I grew up, that meant you were saying something terrible about a woman. And that was not acceptable. My dad was like, you are not going to treat girls that way. And by even saying that, you're putting women in a place that they shouldn't be put. And I said...
You started hanging out with Jesse Pinkman and all was fine.
Right. Hearing him do it is comical. And, you know, I don't see it the same, obviously, because he's referring to grown men as bitches all the time or whatever. So
as long as yo is in front of that, then you're good.
Yeah. But I could never... It was almost impossible for me to be in public or something, and some lady make me mad, like cut me off in her car or anything like that. It is almost impossible for me to say the B word to her or call her that, even when she can't hear me say that she's a B. I can't do it.
Mm-mm.
It's just not. It's not in me to do it. And a lot of people can just let that fly, but that one's not. So like that, Vulcans don't do emotions. It's like that. It's just the same.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's the same.
Lieutenant Uhura, quit being such a bitch.
But if you start that with yo, no, that doesn't work there.
Yo.
Yeoman Rand.
Nice. Well, anyway, we've learned something here, but yeah, continue.
So I guess I'll say Vulcan, although this could be trickery and it could be human, but I'll say Vulcan.
Well, let's find out if it's Vulcan. Yeah, the chat room's right. Also, the C word can't do it.
Oh, God, no, I can't.
It's not in me to say.
Yeah. I can't even use that in joking terms.
I wish I was British. It'd be a lot
like
easier.
The N-word. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it is. I can't do the N-word. I can't do that. And I can't do... I won't lie and say I've never flown the F-bomb when something real bad hurt or happened or something like that. But it's hard for me to just go... I don't know. Whatever, man. You just raised how you're raised. It's just how it is. All right. Here's your answer, Daryl. Let's see if you got it right.
Congratulations.
Oh, very nice.
You're a winner.
She was not presented with the option of taking a Vulcan form. Eventually, she picks the form of a human female. Here's a clip of Riker hitting on her, not knowing she was an android or Data's daughter at the time.
You're new around here, aren't you?
Yes.
Low, low! Put him down.
Commander, what are your intentions toward my daughter? Your daughter? Nice to meet you.
So bad! And that music was so jaunty in the background. All right, Daryl, good job. Way to do it, man. You've done well today. Yesterday, I think you got it wrong, so today is a real turnaround. Daryl's the Trek Nerd on Twitter. He's also thisweekintrek.com and on the Grumpy Cast, and you can find him in all those places. Daryl, now play a game with us. And what is it?
Rejected Star Trek series or 1959 Western starring William Shatner.
Okay, here's your theme.
10 people died in the Bronx last night due to a fire that killed 10 people in the Bronx last night during a fire.
All right, great.
Wait a minute, what was that?
That was an actual news story in New York where the lady got terrible copy to read and reminded me of Anne, what's her name, with her in the news this morning. Good morning.
Yeah. Oh, God. That's like... That is the greatest sentence ever uttered on the news.
It is, and it's sad because people actually died, but it's still so freaking funny. I mean, here it is again.
10 people died in the Bronx last night due to a fire that killed 10 people in the Bronx last night during a fire.
Oh, gosh. Poor lady. It almost sounded fake, but I looked it up, and it was real. Anyway. Daryl, go ahead. But what was the question again? I forgot.
This is a long one. Now I have to read this whole thing.
Sorry.
Again. Rejected Star Trek series or 1959 Western starring William Shatner.
Okay, got it. How many were there that year? All right, go ahead.
Final Frontier.
Final Frontier?
Final Frontier. That He's trying to fake us out with this one.
He is trying to, but there can't be a Western called Final Frontier with Shatner in it. Can there? I would have heard of that. Shatner.
That would have been the greatest irony or the greatest, coincidence in movie history.
Oh my gosh, I had to stop myself. I started looking it up because that's what I would normally do when I'm incensed by trivia like this, and then I stopped myself. Final Frontier. He's fooling with us, dude. We'll talk about him as if he's not in the room.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you say?
He's fooling us one way or the other. He's either trying to make us think it has to be a Star Trek thing.
Yeah.
I mean, Final Frontier sounds like a Western, right? Mm-hmm.
It's also an actual Star Trek movie called Star Trek V, The Final Frontier.
Oh, well, I guess.
And there may be a show that was going to happen. It makes sense that a series would be called that, Star Trek, The Final Frontier. But then that is a movie, so maybe it was rejected before the film.
Mm-hmm. If it were me, I would pick Western, but that's not me.
I just don't know.
It's not just me.
All right, I'll go with you and say Western because I feel like we would have heard of this Star Trek thing before.
I hope I'm not crazy.
All right, what do you say, Daryl?
This was a post TNG animated series developed in 2005 following the cancellation of Enterprise.
Are you kidding? Really?
Wow.
Yeah, it was dropped in 2009.
Why? Everything got dropped for Abrams, didn't it?
Yep.
New shows, cartoons, it all just moved to the side so that freaking JJ lost money Abrams could walk in and take over with his freaking damn robot.
Which he's been doing just fine with. You know what?
Yeah, it's fine. I'm not going to complain. I like him. I like him a lot. Please make Star Wars good, please. Please don't make it poopy.
Television highlights of the news of yesteryear.
It's the news brought to you by...
The TV Music Podcast, which also won't shut up about MASH. MASH. Search for Little Tiny Dot wherever you get your podcasts or visit poddle.fm/LTD.
Hello.
I saw their tweet yesterday.
Oh, yeah, that was totally funny.
We don't know
funny.
Who we are either.
Yeah, that was a great response.
That was.
And it's cool. That was super cool of you guys to be good sports. Because we were not suggesting you guys don't know what you're doing.
Oh, God, no.
It was more like, oh, what are they doing over there? I love the name.
What's Poddle doing?
You know they've got podcasts. Talent. Yeah. Calista Flockhart. Remember her?
I do. She was Allie the McBeal.
She was the McBeal. It only came out twice a year. It was in the shape of ribs, but it was okay. It had pickles on it.
The cold side stayed cold and the hot side stayed hot.
Sure. The McBeal.
And it's Harrison Ford's favorite.
He'd get it every time.
He'd get it every time.
Calista, they're still together, right?
I think so, yeah.
Okay.
They were together as of the last... The Oscars before this one where Ellen ordered them a pizza.
Oh, that's right.
I think.
They were sitting there together. That's right.
They were sitting there together and Harrison Ford almost looked like he had a sense of humor.
That was a better bit than the keep your eyes on the lockbox bit.
Yeah.
Look,
I wanted that to be so much better on that side of things.
I wanted that whole thing to be funnier. And the thing is, I don't hold any of this against Doogie Howser. I think it is the nature of that ugly beast called the Oscars. I just think it's sometimes you get lucky, sometimes you don't. It's never very good.
The edginess has to be in these little dribs and drabs. So just when you think, all right, well, maybe this will be a slightly edgier Oscars and we can, have a lot funnier jokes and No. Just one joke, and then we've got to pare it down and kiss Jack Nicholson's butt, who wasn't there.
Was he not there?
No.
This time?
Usually front row, but not this time.
That's too bad.
They like cutting to him laughing at things.
Yeah. He's always got to be on the front row. Laker games, Oscars. Right.
It's the eyesight.
My bar mitzvah, which I didn't have because I'm not Jewish. It's the eyesight. Nice.
Yes, I can't see.
And he's got those sunglasses on. Yeah. Yeah, we're going to find out he's like Bono. He's got some kind of weird eyesight problem. We'll feel bad about it. Not really. He's fine. He sleeps in a pile of money. Calista Flockhart joins the Supergirl pilot. She's returning to network television after her last thing, which was Brothers and Sisters. Remember that thing? That was on.
Oh, yeah, right.
Kind of like Parenthood for snotty people.
Right, it was like 30-something.
Yeah, kind of like that. Anyway, she'll be opposite Melissa Benoist. Is that right? Benoist?
Benoist?
Benoist? That's probably not Benoist.
I like Benoist.
In the CBS pilot, she's going to be in the pilot for Supergirl. She will play Kara's boss, Kat Grant, in the project, reuniting Brothers and Sisters executive producer Greg Berlanti with her. Based on the DC comic, DC, here we go again with DC shows. Supergirl from Warner Brothers TV studio based Berlanti Productions. The writers, executive producers Berlanti and Ali Adler centers on the Kar-Zor-El, who is Supergirl. Since arriving on Earth, the Krypton-born Kara has been hiding her powers, and she shares with her favorite cousin, Superman. I wonder if he'll ever show up.
Yeah, I wonder if Flash and Arrow will show up, because Greg Berlanti, you know, that those are his deals as well. So
Yeah, good point.
But they're for the CW, and this is CBS. I don't know. It'd be really cool.
Awesome crossover, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
They did this. CBS and NBC did this back in the day with Law and Order and Homicide: Life on the Streets. Those crossed over. And in fact, little known fact here, the character, now if I have this wrong, someone correct me, but I've been led to believe, and I guess we could look this up, but I think Richard Belzer's character,
Munch,
was the same character on Homicide: Life on the Streets and got transferred to the department he's in now as an actual character in Law and Order SVU. I'm pretty sure that's the deal. And I don't think that's ever, but that's some stunt TV there, man.
No, that is, yeah, exactly.
We were talking the other day.
Not since Battle of the All-Star, the Battle of the Network All-Stars have we seen.
I know, right? That much crossover? That's crazy. Oh, I wish they'd do that again. Don't you wish they'd do that again?
Battle of the Network All-Stars?
Yeah.
Yeah, we've talked about it before, but it would be great to see. It would just be great to see, like, you know, people like, I don't know, Dennis Franz competing with...
Whoever.
Julie Bowen and...
It'd be amazing. Why
Zoe
not?
Zoe Deschanel running across
Is Dennis Franz doing things right now?
I don't
okay.
think he is.
That's a good name.
That's the first name that came to mind, because I was thinking NYPD Blue and Life on the Street and Homicide.
Well, he's great. I wish he'd come back. But look, the old...
Melissa Hargitay just fell in the mud pit from the tug of war. Followed closely by that guy who plays Schmidt on New Girl.
The guy who plays Schmidt. You could totally do it. The MTV tried this some years ago with that. Remember the basketball game they'd all play?
Oh, yeah, right.
For charity, and they'd have, like, you know, current stars and then rappers and people like that playing. I'd be all for that. Make it a big charity thing. It's super ironic now, so people would just have a good laugh, right? Like, it's not going to ruin your career or say that you're lame. Shows like Dancing with the Stars says you're lame.
Right.
So this would be better than that. Anyway.
Oh, here we go. So, yeah, Practice and Boston Public did it as well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's right.
Ally McBeal and The Practice, both David E. Kelly shows on different networks crossed over. So,
oh, that's right, because CB, you're right, yeah. Boston Public was a
ABC?
Fox show, wasn't it? And then Boston
Fox.
Legal
sorry, was
CBS
Fox,
or something. Hold on, let me think. Yeah, Boston Legal. Were those even? I don't know. Who knows? But yeah, there's got to be a list. Someone find the definitive list, please. Thank you very much.
So the bottom line is, it could happen.
Yeah, that's all we're saying. Forget the banana wearable we talked about yesterday.
I've forgotten about it already.
Good, because I got a new one for you. Here is a new wearable.
This I couldn't believe.
This will feed you tomatoes as you run.
So now... Lots of questions.
Well, let's answer the first one. Yes, it does come from Japan. All right, now ask your other questions.
All right. Are tomatoes some, is there some positive thing that happens when you eat a tomato while you're running?
Well, what they're claiming is its antioxidant power is released when you eat them while you run, and that somehow is better to do it then to release that power, because you got blood pumping through your system and your metabolism is on high gear, and therefore it will turbo blast the antioxidant power of the tomatoes through your physical body. That's their claim.
Okay.
There's no proof to any of it, but that's their claim.
I do love the look of this thing.
Oh, it's awesome.
I mean, as goofy as the banana was yesterday, mm-hmm. this I think is the best thing ever.
It's pretty
especially
awesome.
Especially the expression painted on the front of the tomato head of the robot.
It is the stupidest freaking thing. Chat room, do they have the link?
I gave them a
link.
All
right, good, because you got to see that. I'm going to play a little of this video. I think it's in Japanese. It's a guy running, slow motion, on his treadmill, eating a tomato. You know, like you do, Brian, on the treadmill.
Yeah, I do that so often.
Often eating a tomato.
Tomatoes and treadmills go together like skiing and taxis.
Oh my gosh, that the Tron guy who ate the tomato is the best thing.
Oh yeah, because he's lighting up.
Let's skip ahead here.
Powerful.
Oh my gosh, this is a real product. Look at this.
That is amazing. I was watching her eat the banana.
It's amazing. That guy's amazing.
It's like a Kickstarter video. I thought to myself, I see all these women going by eating bananas. And it came to me, I need a way to eat tomatoes while I'm running.
Oh, they're so messy, though. Like, yeah, that's terrible. Anyway, all right. That's a thing. You can get that. Hey, I have a better way for you to eat, though.
Mm-hmm. Tell us.
And that's this. You get a hold of HelloFresh.com by going there and seeing what their chefs have created this week. They make real food, real recipes. And tomatoes might be part of it. I don't know. It depends on the week. You order the one you want, and they'll send you the exact farm fresh ingredients straight to your door. And then you just make whatever that amazing meal was in 30 minutes or less. That's better than having some robot feed you tomatoes.
Way better.
Way, way better.
Because everybody wins, yeah. Right? It's not just you.
Well, you still get
tomato
the
tomato robot. Everybody who enjoys the meal with
And you
wins.
Still get the... You know what? Why don't they just inject... Why doesn't the robot inject you constantly with needles filled with, like, liquid tomato juice or something?
Yeah, because that seems like a good idea. Have have something poking you with needles while your arms are flailing and you're...
Well, maybe if it's in your butt, you can... It'll motivate you to run faster or something. I don't know. It's a terrible idea. Use Morning Stream at checkout for 50% off your first order while you're over there at HelloFresh. That's HelloFresh.com and the code Morning Stream. There's a real reason why John Traavolta goofed on Idina Menzel's name or whatever you say her name. And I don't even know how to say it right anymore.
Idina Menzel.
Thank you. It's not
the wickedly talented Idina Menzel.
But
we'd still be laughing. You know what? If he would have said the name right, I think we would have still laughed at him because of his whole the wickedly talented Idina Menzel.
That part was the best part. On Jimmy Kimmel Live's special post-Oscar show, John Traavolta explained once and for all what led him to mangle her name at the last Oscar ceremony.
Now that he's had a year to think about it.
Yeah, yeah. A little time. He could have said it that day, the day after. Anyway, he says he rushed for time because he was supposed to present. He only had a minute and 15 seconds to prepare rather than the 15 minutes he was originally told because the page that was supposed to escort him on stage got stuck in an elevator. That sounds like a nightmare. Oh, my gosh. Can you imagine getting stuck in an elevator when you're trying to be working the Oscars? That's crazy.
Right. Oh.
He then ran into Goldie Hawn backstage. He says, now, Goldie Hawn is charismatic, sexy, and beautiful, and I was starstruck. You know what? This is starting to sound like Bull Schmidt to me.
Mm-hmm.
He says, Traavolta said he was busy hugging and loving her up when he realized he needed to be on stage. Then, just before he went on, they changed the spelling of Menzel's name to the proper phonetic spelling. When he saw it, he said to himself, I don't know that name. But Traavolta says the flub actually worked in Menzel's favor. She'd had one of the best years of her career, and she gives me credit. Really?
Wow.
I don't think it has... Dude, he's bonkers.
Yeah,
he's lost control of his sense of reality. I'm telling you, these these guys that are all part of Scientology, they're not doing that that organization any favors for an already struggling PR world that they're facing every day. It doesn't help that that Tom Cruise and this guy say crazy crap all the time.
No, it really doesn't. It doesn't do anything for them. I like how Travolta's trying to turn lemons into crazy.
Crazy aid.
Crazy aid.
That sounds yummy.
What's he doing with Goldie Hawn, though, backstage?
He's loving her up, dude. Loving her up. What does that even mean, loving her
up? I've seen Kelly Preston. She's nothing to sneeze at.
Yeah. She's hugging and loving her up. Didn't it all get proven he's just gay and won't admit it, though? Like,
oh, I don't know if it's been proven.
I thought they found pictures of him making out with
there were rumored pilot. Pictures and, you know. We talked about it here on this show that there's been rumors of it, and there was the photos of him with his hand on the pilot's penis or something coming off the plane. Or, who knows?
I don't remember that. Okay, chat room. This is the stuff everyone offers as proof right there. So that's him and his pilot.
Oh, that's the one, yeah.
And that is definitely not his
Travolta's
penis.
Travolta's a super affectionate guy, as shown by the Vulcan mind meld he was trying to do on Menzel at the... at the Oscars.
Or the alien too close to Ripley moment in
first Scarlett Johansson. Yeah, yes. Yeah. That is one of the best pictures ever. Just the look on Scarlett Johansson's face.
Yeah. I think he should just be openly, who cares if you're gay? No one cares anymore. Just say you're gay. Everyone's gay.
Great if Scarlett Johansson said, he smells like beef.
Like beef. I don't see how it's a party. Let's see. Wesley Snipes in the news again. Tax dodger, zombie killer.
Always bet on black.
Or vampire killer, sorry. Yeah, Wesley Snipes. Right. Jumps out of a plane in a parachute, also stays on that plane and fights the bad guys. And what else does he do? Do we care about anything else?
He beats up Sylvester Stallone, and he's the butcher of... what was he? The butcher of something.
No, I don't remember.
In Demolition Man.
Yeah, he was the new... He had the crazy hair in New Jack City.
Yep.
And he told Woody he was white and therefore couldn't jump.
that's right.
That's all of them. That's all the movies.
Right. That's all of them. That is every Wesley Snipes thing that you need to know.
I do like Blade 1 and 2 a lot. I think 3 is lame, but 1 and 2 are great. Well, Wesley Snipes has joined NBC. Speaking of pilots, an NBC pilot, Endgame, gets Wesley Snipes to come on television again to show himself after running from the IRS for so long. Co-starring opposite Strike Back's Philip Winchester. What's Strike Back?
I don't know. Those four words, Strike Back and Philip Winchester, do nothing for me.
Well, all right. So it's some drama pilot called Endgame. Also cast in the project from Leverage co-creator John Rogers. You got Blacklist producers David Davis Entertainment and Sony TV. You got David Cupton. Oh, yeah. Another name I don't know. David Cupton.
From the world of Damon Gupton.
Oh, it's Gupton, not Cupton. Gupton.
Saving
Gupton. Now, what's that movie? Following Gupton. Eating Gupton. Who's eating Gupton's grape? What am I trying to think of? It's the Robin Williams movie. It's Saving Gupton. Gupper for the win. Kate Gupton, that's it. Kate Gupton's weird torso.
Let's see.
Oh, The World According to Garp is what I'm thinking
of. Oh, that's what you're thinking
of.
Okay.
Couldn't be more off.
Wow.
Described as a high-octane thriller set in the high-stakes world of, like this high-octane set in the high-stakes world of Las Vegas. Endgame centers on Alex Winchester, Alex, who's played by Winchester, a former intelligence officer turned security expert who is drawn into Damon's mysterious conspiracies that forces him to complete a series of heroic challenges in order to save innocent lives. That sounds convoluted as hell.
Yeah.
But good luck.
Yeah, I'm
you like shows set in Vegas, though. So
every show set in Vegas. You know, I never watched the one that was actually called Las Vegas with James Caan, although I do remember that Twin Peaks gal was blown off a rooftop.
Yep. It also had Josh Duhamel in it.
Yeah, that's right. It had Josh Duhamel.
And also had other people and lots of guest stars.
It did. It had other people.
Yeah, had a lot of guest stars. I want to say...
And I didn't watch that one that was the musical. Wasn't that David Bochco or Stephen Bochco? It was like a...
oh, right.
Viva Laughlin.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
Yeah.
So
a lot of people did.
Yeah. I don't think that did very well. What's Bochco doing? Is he doing anything? He hasn't done anything in a long time.
I don't know what Bochco's doing.
Stephen?
You know the guy's got talent.
Bochco. Okay. He
Cop
is
Rock three.
Currently under production. He's still got some suave hair, that guy. Look at that. Wow. All right, hold on. IMDb is having a fart. Come on, IMDb. All right, we'll wait for that. But I want to see what he's up to. You know he's got talent.
Yeah.
Squarespace.com sponsoring today's show.
They've got talent.
Do they ever, man. And they're on like their seventh version of the tools and stuff. And thinking the other day, one of the main advantages or one of the reasons I really like Squarespace is that their designs now and their templates and stuff just freaking work across all kinds of devices. So instead of having to worry about, all right, we got to do separate like mobile development for phones and tablets and stuff, let's go do that. That's a big pain. I mean, the phones have to detect it, and then you got to like switch to mobile, and it's just a big old messy overhead, blah, 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 when you're making your own site. Turns out, not so with Squarespace. That stuff is dumb easy over there. It's just automatic in most cases. Most of those templates just poop right over to mobile, and it's fantastic. Cool. So if you want to go make a website, and you're like, I want to chronicle everything Wesley Snipes has ever done and build a big fan page for him, well, then use them, sell T-shirts, buy domains, do it all at squarespace.com, and do it all for a little bit less money. At checkout, use the code MORNING. That'll get you 10% off your account at squarespace.com. That's squarespace.com and the checkout code MORNING. All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, Fitness Geek, Jury Duty, and your calls. Brian brought music. What is it?
I did. This is going out to Sunny, a.k.a. Sunbun in the Tadpole. Hi, Scoopy and Bam Bam. Wanted to say thanks to start off. I started listening to TMS in the summer of last year, and it's the best part of my day. It makes long, rage-filled commutes to school infinitely more enjoyable. Oh my God, rage-filled. Yeah. Yikes. I'm turning 23 on Monday, and nobody likes you when you're 23. Nobody likes you when you're 23. But maybe you guys will. Mm. I'd like to request a cover of Blink-182's What's My Age Again. Thanks, and let's grab a froyo. Sunny.
Nice.
And that line came from What's My Age Again, of course, by Blink-182. How about an acoustic cover by the Doc Brown duo, Marty? Came out on their album, or I guess released as a single in 2011. What's My Age Again, the acoustic version, performed by the Doc Brown duo.
Cool. Hold on. Where is it? You know, it'd be good if I had it queued up. Oh, there it is.
Whoops. Sorry.
I got it now. No, you'd be sorry. I had
it too fast with that intro.
I had it on the wrong page. Here it is. It's that, and I'll play it now. We'll be back in a minute. Stay tuned.
I took her out. It was a Friday night. I work alone to get the feeling right. We started making out, and she took off my pants. But then I turned on the TV. About the time she walked away from me. Nobody likes you when you're 23, and you're still more amused by TV shows. Oh, what the hell is ADD? My friends say I should act my age. What's my age again? What's my age again? And later on the drive home, I called her mom from a payphone. I said I was the cops and your husband's in jail. The state looks down on sodomy. And that's about the time that bitch hung up on me. Nobody likes you when you're 23, and I'm still more amused by prank phone calls. Oh, what the hell is call ID? My friends say I should act my age. What's my age again? What's my age again? Time she walked away from me. Nobody liked you when you're 23, and you still act like you're in freshman year. Oh, what the hell is wrong with me? My friends say I should act my age. What's my age again? And that's about the time that she broke up with me. No one should take themselves so seriously. So many years ahead to fall in line. Oh, why would you wish that on me? I never wanna act my age. What's my age again? What's my age again? What's my age again? What's my age again?
Charges receipts, invoices, statements, taxes, budgets, paperwork, pollution. There's just no getting around it. Okay, then, get through it. Now from Sharp, maker of the world's most complete line of electronic calculators, the LC8. World's smallest electronic calculator by Sharp.
Your hooking's too weak. You have to hook it stronger.
A great pair of nerd glasses in about an hour. This is the Morning Stream.
And we're back. Welcome back. That was a lovely rendition of that song.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it immensely.
Very pleasant.
Yeah, I would agree with that. We've been hooking it wrong. You must hook stronger.
What game is that? Is that clip from?
I don't know. Our friend Hammond Chamberlain sent me those, and I'm not sure where he capped those from, today's versions of those, but they are classic. I don't know who would say this.
Your hooking's too weak. You have to hook it stronger.
That's some bad translation, dude.
It really is.
That other one.
It's a game where you play, it's like a hooker simulation.
This one's my favorite because of the ending is supposed to be all intense, but it's not.
Here you go. They're still chasing me. Wah!
It's so bad. Oh, mid-90s.
Let me do that again. I think I can do it better. No worries. We got it.
Mid-90s voice acting in video games. Was there anything better than that? No is the answer. No is the answer.
No.
All right, Brian. Let's get... who's on? Bill. Let's get Bill on.
Okay.
Hold on a second.
I feel so proud to talk to Bill after almost a full week of treadmill on.
Oh, good. You've been
new treadmill.
You've been consistent then, you say.
I have. Did a run through Disneyland today via satellite view because there's not street. The Google cars did not drive through Disneyland, so I had to do it from a top-down view.
Well, here's this.
Yeah.
All right, that's Bill. That's Bill's sound. Here's another one. It's Bill Duran on the phone. Hello, Bill.
Morning, you guys.
Hey, man.
Good morning.
How you doing? How's your vacation? You're back from Florida now, I guess.
Yes, and Florida was cold, which is horse apples.
Wow, no kidding.
Yeah, it was like it was just windy, cold. Ruined the whole thing. That's not true.
Hold on now. So when you went down there, you went there like for beach stuff and all that, and it was I've never heard of Florida being cold. I guess that surprises me. Yep. I guess this time of year it's not as predictable to be warm, I suppose.
Well, that East Coast weather has been off the chain.
So
apparently.
So what part of America's wiener were you on? Which beach?
I was in the Gulf Coast called Sanibel Island.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah,
I've been near there. Not quite there, but near there. Well, that's fantastic. I'm glad you're back and in one piece and you took some lovely photos and seem to have a nice relaxing time. Vacations are good when you can muster them.
Temporary Florida man.
Yeah.
Temporary, yeah.
Florida.
Don't want to live there.
No, you don't. Well, it's good to have you back. Bill's the fitness geek. Comes on the show, talks about how to be a nerd in the current century, but still keep yourself fit and well-fed, I suppose. And what do you got today? What's going on?
My wife, actually, Brittany, found this really cool website. I only really got to check it out yesterday, but it looks pretty neat. It's called neilarey.com. That's neilarey.com. If folks want to go check it out at home. Mm-hmm. And it's devoted to fitness, just this big old sort of compendium with all kinds of fitness.
Wow.
In fact, they have a thing all about it. The NR Project is an independent fitness resource run and maintained by a small group of volunteers and fitness enthusiasts. It looks pretty neat.
Yeah.
When you go there, if you go to this website, right away there's like these six big images up there, and that's kind of like their thing. There's a new this week, and then there's this sort of loop workout, whatever that is. It's just all kinds of really great fitness resources, and they're really, really accessible. So, for example, like you're thinking, I want to work out today, but I don't know what I should do. Looking for ideas. There's an I'm feeling lucky button, which is kind of neat.
It's a shuffle. Yeah.
Yeah. You just click on that. And the one that popped up for me, and some of these are like geeky themed, which is kind of fun. This one's called The Sherlock. I don't know why.
I get the Amazon.
Yeah. Amazon.
What does the Amazon do?
10 jump squats, 10 jumping lunges, 10 hop heel clicks, 6 push-ups, 4 close grip push-ups, 40 punches, and then 20 seconds each, elbow planks, raised leg planks, and side planks.
Oh, I got you. Okay, so it's not like they're always a full meal of complimentary workout stuff. Okay.
Yep.
So I did one yesterday. It was the Mario one, and they were all like jump up and pretend you're punching a box over your head, or
really,
or pretend you're like kicking a turtle shell or whatever.
Can you pretend you're eating a special mushroom that makes you feel all powerful? And...
yeah, and then instead of working out, you just sit on the couch all day thinking that you worked out.
Yeah, eating a big shiitake mushroom, going, yeah, baby. That's cool. I like that there's a playfulness to what you're describing to me. Yeah.
And there are really great instructional images to show what you should be doing with your workouts.
Yeah, I love that.
There are different there are different levels. Like level 1, do 3 sets. Level 2, do 5 sets. Level 3, do 7 sets. Mm. And then rest up to 2 minutes. A lot of them, if they require timing, like do this for 30 seconds, there'll be a timer right on the website. So you just hit that, do your workout thing, and then you do your rest. And they also have resting, resting timers as well. So you can just click that, and it's got a little timer, 30 seconds.
I love stuff like this, because there's this simplicity to this that is missing from a lot of the other like apps and sites and things that are trying to drive you to do things. They get so complicated or so, I don't know. There's a tendency to get a lot of feature creep when you make stuff like this.
Yes.
Sometimes you just need... the quick thing, the core thing, and not try to also talk me into signing up for food tracking and a million other things. Right. I just want to do thing.
The Super Mario is great because you do running and then jumping and then punching and then kicking. It's really funny, actually.
That's how you feel at the end.
You collapsing in a heap on the floor.
Yeah. This one's pretty good. It's the Black Widow. Ooh. And the lady in the picture has red hair. And she does all kinds of cool sort of fitness. Back kicks and punches and triangle crunches. Those look pretty.
Are there any out there that make me
flop around like a marionette?
Any of those?
I bet there are. Keep clicking through here. The Matrix. There's one called The Matrix. Side-to-side lunges.
What?
The whole time you can pretend you're Neo.
This is cool. I like this because they've got that thing, the 8 weeks to 5K running program. So, like, it's, day 1, 2-minute run, 2-minute walk, do that 2 sets, and then 10 squats the next day. So it's not like all running, it's like alternating. Ah, this is so cool.
Yeah, I'm going to use this. Give people the domain one more time so they know.
So NEILAREY.com or Neela Ray.
Neela Ray.
Or NR workout or something like that. It looks like, I love the like you said, the simplicity of like, I just need to work out. I'm feeling lucky. Let's just do that one. Mm-hmm. There's also this Hero's Journey. It's a 60-day program. It's 60 days worth of workouts that you could chew through that I imagine get more difficult as it goes. It looks like there's a forum. There's all kinds of challenges. There's a thing about running, about nutrition. And then one of my favorites is just this one page that's motivation. It's just like motivational posters.
That's great.
I need something to help me get started today. Let's go. This one says, in the face of pain, we are all equal, bro.
Oh, this is awesome.
These are these meal plans. Also cool, by the way. So there's like this modern hero diet, and it lays out what breakfast should be. And there's choices, but it's like, if you want weight loss and maintenance, here's good meal plans.
Yep.
If you want vegetarian ideas, here's those meal plans. But again, they're presented in this simple, like, big, easy to understand.
Page.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. I really like this, like, a lot. I've been looking for this. So where the hell were these guys when I was looking for them?
Yeah, I already know what giving up feels like. I want to see what happens if I don't.
Yeah, right.
Yes. I like the 10 reasons to get fit. Number 10 is you become harder to kill.
That's pretty good.
It's excellent.
It's great.
This is awesome. This may be one of my favorite ones you've brought to us.
I'm surprised I haven't heard of it until now.
Thanks to Britt for finding this.
Definitely, yeah. It's very robust. There's tons of content. It looks really neat. I'm going to print out one of these motivation things. I'll just print it out and stick it on the wall. I'll put it on the fridge. That's what I'll do.
Oh, there you go. Yeah.
That's really cool. I wish they had no apps I'm seeing here. Maybe they'll, if we have enough of us donate, they have a donation thing at the bottom. Enough of us donate to the project, maybe one day they'll build an app. That'd be awesome.
Oh, yeah, an app would be perfect for this.
I'm wondering, I'll have to double check, but I'm wondering if it looks just good on my phone, because I could just go to the website on my phone then hit I'm feeling lucky and I got my workout right there.
See? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I'm
going to do this. I got this one that says, I'm going to be strong today. I tried it yesterday and I think I'm hooked. Mm. I'm going to print that out and put it on my fridge.
I also like, what's this one called? The Bane.
Yeah.
And there's a huge picture. There's a big silhouette of Bane in the background.
Right.
Lift a car over your head.
It's too bad you don't have to do these workouts with your hands over your mouth. My punishment will be severe if I don't finish this.
Take back your body, Gotham. That kind of stuff. They have the Flash. That's cool. Green Lantern. You know what? This looks like nerds made this, and that makes me super happy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is the poster child.
Everything's polished. Mm-hmm. It looks like it's really easy to use.
Very cool, dude.
God, these recipes are great, too.
Yeah, I'll bookmark the hell out of this. Yeah. Very nice. This is, like I said, one of my favorite things you've ever brought to us. He's also doing lots of other cool things. What else is happening this week people should watch? Anything cool?
Well, I am going to be a guest at London Super Comic Con.
Mm.
So that's cool. Any of our UK listeners are going to be there.
When's that, by the way?
That is March 14th and 15th.
Oh, goodness.
Over there across the pond, so I'm flying over there. That means I need a new costume done by then, and I'm working on my Destiny costume.
They won't
and
let
it's
that.
Like 3 weeks away.
They won't let your current stink bag into the country. You gotta watch. You gotta have something.
Yeah.
You have to ship your stink bag in.
Yeah, that's right. So I'm working on that. A handful of other projects. I'm gonna be just slamming on getting that thing done. But also, we mentioned a couple weeks ago the video that my friend Todd over at Cosplay Boom did. It went on Kotaku. I made a link for that in case anyone wants to go check it out. It's really like kind of a behind the scenes look into not just what I do as far as my career, but you know, they interview my friends and my wife and kind of get into the real me, if you want to.
I love that video. It's extremely well made.
Yes, Todd did a great job. The link I made is bit.ly/punishedboom, B-O-O-M.
That's boom.
All one word.
Boom.
So if folks want to go check that out.
Not punished, not punished womb, because I knew a lady who had 8 children, and I would say she had a punished womb. That's what I would say.
Agree.
Yeah. All right, well, that's cool. That's all good. As always, Chinbeard on Twitter, and check him out at punishedprops.com. Bill, always a pleasure.
You know it.
See you next time. Bye now. Oh, I hung up on him before he could say goodbye. Because that's how I do.
See how you are?
I see how I am. All right. I heard from Justin yesterday, so I know he's around. We'll chat with him.
Good.
About things that matter.
Good.
I got a phone call for him, actually, that we're going
to play. Oh, really? Something for us to play when he's on?
Yeah. Specific to him. His 3 dots are rising.
Oh, boy.
That means he's probably in the shitter. You know, that's one word I do enjoy.
The shitter?
No, the word shitter, shite, it's one of my favorites. Yeah. There's something...
Merry Christmas! Shitter was full!
Somebody said he was coming out of hiding for something. What was it? Somebody said he was going to come out and do some guest spot on some show and that everyone was going to be surprised, yeah.
Oh, that'd be fantastic.
Oh, that'd be a thrill a minute.
I would love to see that, yeah.
All right, let's see. Well, this is interesting. They're adding new workouts every week on this site. So new this week, the Amazon, the Bane, the Valkyrie, all that stuff, that's all new stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. February 20th.
I love it, too, like the modern hero diet, weight loss and maintenance. Like, you know, you've got like 6 options for breakfasts and 6 options for lunch, and it's really cool.
Yeah, I'm digging it. I'm going to use
chicken
this all the
chips
time.
Chips with cucumber.
They need an app. Some
chips are.
Some fierce, though. All right, here we go.
These are their stories.
I'm terrible with names.
Justine Robert Bateman is on the line with us. Hello, Justin. Hello. Oh, is he not there? He's there. Can you hear us? Is your...
Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you now. Hello.
Good.
Hi.
That was so old school.
It was old school.
With the misnames there.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Justine Bateman. Yeah. Ooh, listen to you. Ooh. That's horsey.
Yeah. Well, no, here's the thing. It's like this cough that just will not go away.
Yeah.
It's been with me forever. Yeah. I'm almost positive it's something terrible.
Yeah, it may be. Like, have you gone in to get checked for, like, bronchitis or something?
No, I'm afraid of doctors.
You should go in there, dude. They won't touch your wiener. It's fine. They'll check down your throat.
The only doctor I trust poops on my floor.
Yep, little white poops from Dr. Bird. Well, I hope you're, yeah, I hope you're all right. That cough thing is a thing this year, though. People, my daughter's had one for like 3 months. You can't shake it.
Oh, really? I had it really bad, and now it's kind of just in the morning. Like, I think it's just it's something phlegmy. It's a Flemish problem.
Oh, it's a Flemish origin.
It is a Flemish origin, as are the swan paintings that adorn my hallway.
Of course. So where are you? You're traveling somewhere, I can tell.
Yes and no. It's a local game today, but I just had to go into the office a little early. So I am on the fabulous Bay Bridge.
Oh, good. It's a national landmark. People love it there. Well, I'm going to share with you a phone call to get us started, okay? Someone called in about you, and this question, I forget.
But have a number now where people can call?
Oh, yeah. We have a little voicemail number.
The Justin Robert Young hotline.
Mm-hmm. That's what we call it.
Yeah. Rock and roll. Go.
All right. Here it is. Whoops. Hold on. It's right here. Here we go. Oh, come on. Here we go.
The Morning Stream. A question for Brian, Scott, and Jerry regarding this Tuesday's most recent segment. The movie, Still Waiting, great movie or greatest movie? Thank you.
Still Waiting, great movie or greatest movie? Now, well, I don't even know what the hell that movie is.
Well, I don't know whether or not they mean Waiting, the movie about...
Oh
no. You mean the diner movie?
I don't know.
Or the restaurant movie?
I'm thinking of Waiting. Oh, Still Waiting is the... You're right. It's a complimentary eatery, steals their customers, restaurant employees hatch a raunchy plan to drum up business.
It's a sequel.
What is this?
Because it was Waiting.
Oh, then they're Still Waiting. Oh, okay, you're right. It is a sequel, and it was direct-to-video. And it's got Adam Carolla, John Mitchell Higgins, Bob Benedict. This looks terrible.
It really does.
And it's got like a terrible review on IMDb. All right, let's try to call Justin back.
Okay.
I guess I should focus on that for a second. Maybe he got a call. He could have gotten a call. On the Bay Bridge. What's that song about the Bay Bridge? Oh, crap. Come on, Brian. Help me out.
I don't know the song on the Bay Bridge.
Somebody jumped off the Bay Bridge with the...
You're not thinking of Ode to Billy Joel when he jumped off the Tallahatchie Bridge.
Oh, that's the one I'm thinking of. Never mind. That's
well,
the one.
Bridge. You got Bridge, so there's that.
I used to think that was one of the most haunting songs. Like, I know it's supposed to be, kind of, right? But I remember hearing it as a kid and being just, I couldn't get it out of my head. I'd go weeks just obsessing about what I heard in that song and how scary that sounded and how sad it was. It's something about when you're a kid, man. These things you hear and see, they just stick with you. And that was one of them. I'll tell you a modern day version, though. You know, the one about abortion by Ben Folds 5?
Oh, Brick?
Yeah. I never knew it was about abortion until recently. But anyway, like 2002, a bad winter here in Utah and Salt Lake City. And I was driving in the morning. It was foggy. Everything is encrusted in like frost and snow. The streets were clear, but they were all kind of white from like that stuff that they put on the streets to melt the ice and all that, the salt.
Right, right.
And that song comes on. You know the one.
Mm-hmm.
And it is now permanently associated with cold and snow.
Well, that's certainly the kind of feeling that song evokes, right?
Yeah.
Like the kind of atmosphere.
Yeah.
Very bleak, desolate,
I can't get it out. Like what? Yeah. How do I change it? Is there a way to change it? Can I not hear "Flight" or "Ride of the Valkyries" without hearing "Kill the Wabbit" over and over in my head? It's not possible.
Or the Parks and Recreation theme is "Jabba the Hutt."
Yeah, that's right. That's another good one. All right, Justin, are you back? You're back.
Yeah, I'm back. I don't know what the hell happened.
You hit a pocket. There's pockets.
Yeah, there are stupid pockets.
Yeah, I've seen some things with pockets when people call, and I think you were in one. So they're talking about this, I guess, sequel, direct-to-video sequel to Waiting called Still Waiting.
Well, I mean, but that would be very odd because, like, the Waiting is kind of the like canonical, like, oh, we work in restaurants. It has all the restaurant tropes, kind of movie. I don't know if I've ever seen Still Waiting.
Mm-hmm.
I think still the only original cast member from Still Waiting is Luis Guzman as like the cook.
Yeah, he's the only one. You're right.
Right. Yeah, looking through the list here.
I mean, it's Adam Carolla is in the sequel, and it was direct to video. That seems like a combo that meant that there were low expectations.
I'm going to assume that the caller, and correct me if I'm wrong, but they mean waiting. Like, and waiting is, I don't know how funny that movie is to have it worked in a restaurant. If you worked in a restaurant, I think it's very funny in that, like, here's a shared experience that is very relevant to one distinct workplace. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like, if they just made a workplace comedy about riveters, and it was just like all these hilarious things where the main character got a hot rivet in his pants or something.
It could be called riveting.
It would be called riveting.
The sequel would be still riveting.
Still riveting.
Yeah. So she said still waiting. Maybe she meant waiting. Let's assume she meant waiting, because this whole the whole thing spawned from last week, you talking about restaurants, which, by the way, got a lot of response because people felt like you really nailed the thing.
The restaurant aesthetic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well,
yeah.
It's an odd field. It really is, like, it's like legal drug dealing. Like, and not to say that in any of the products of drug dealing, but in that, like, you end up with a couple, you know, like, hundreds of dollars in cash in your drawers for mm-hmm. one reason or another. Mm-hmm. Like, when I used to work as a busboy, I would just have a drawer with, like, ones. Like, my drawers and the drawers of a stripper were shockingly similar, like, from the ages of 15 to 17.
Yeah, I could see that. That sounds about right. Well, for whatever reason, you touched this nerve. A lot of people spent time working in restaurants in one form or another. I did growing up. So everything you said, you know, struck me as real and relevant. But this idea that either of the waiting movies is the greatest film of all time.
No, I mean, all right. So here's what you can say about waiting. Number one, it is in that brief, glorious 4-year span in which we thought Ryan Reynolds was going to be Eddie Murphy or Will Ferrell or something, where you could just, like, basically he was going to be a, like, when Will Ferrell is killing the game and Ryan Reynolds comes along and they're like, oh my God, this guy is, like, you know, a cuter Will Ferrell, Jim Carrey kind of thing. Mm-hmm. We can just put him in comedies. Chicks love him because he's cute. Boys love him because he's funny. We cannot make enough Ryan Reynolds movies. So you make Van Wilder. And then, like, this is another... This was basically, like, his Blades of Glory, you know?
to continue the Will Ferrell connection?
Yeah, okay. Exactly. So it's like, whatever, we have Will Ferrell in this movie, but we can't just have him be, like, a dude in every movie, so we have to give him weird jobs. It was like wrestlers in the 80s. Everyone was defined by their job.
Yeah.
They had literally nothing else going for them.
Right.
That's... He's the centerpiece of it. It stars, I think, at the time that he was doing, or immediately after, Freaks and Geeks, one of the Freaks and Geeks kids.
Oh, who was it?
I think I'm getting this mixed up. It's
You're thinking of Justin Long, the Mac, is who you're thinking
No. I'm thinking of the... So basically, the whole movie centers around a new kid getting trained.
Okay.
Right.
And like all the wacky people that are there.
Oh no,
like,
you're dead right. It's John Francis Daly. He was in Freaks and Geeks.
Oh, yeah.
Gotcha.
He was the kid.
Yeah, the kid.
The main center kid.
Yeah. He ended up later on Bones, that's CSI ripoff Bones. Mm-hmm. But yeah, that's the kid, and he would have been
he's
more
a writer
of a kid
now. He wrote the incredible Burt Wonderstone.
Oh, he wrote that? Oh, yeah, he did. Weird.
Yeah, he's got, like, a bunch of writing credits now.
Yeah, he's in a bunch of other stuff. So he was on Bones for, like, a bunch of seasons, 5 or 6 seasons. He was, and that just ended last year. And now he's in something called Dude Bro Party Massacre 3.
Which is in post-production, so they're just putting the finishing touches on that masterpiece.
Yeah, polishing up that diamond.
Yeah.
Ready to bring it to the fair.
He wrote the screenplay for Cloudy with a Chance of Meatballs 2, which I didn't was kind of terrible compared to the first one. So I'm starting to wonder here.
Because, like, the guys who wrote the first one are maybe the best comedy writers in the game right now.
Yeah, this is
true.
Yeah,
it's hard.
Now, I didn't know this was even in the works, but I'd like to share something with everyone.
Yeah, go ahead.
This is going to blow your minds. He just wrote, and the movie is in post-production. Supposed to come out this year. That's the first I'm hearing of this. A vacation movie, which features young father Rusty Griswold gearing up to take his family on vacation. So it is a new vacation movie Chevy Chase appears briefly in.
Yeah.
But is all and, about Chris Hemsworth, Leslie
Audrey's,
Mann.
Audrey's husband is Chris Hemsworth, yeah.
What the heck, dude?
Yeah, Jason Sudeikis is...
This is... He's Rusty? Oh, shit.
We lose Jeff. That's right.
Oh, you're back. So Jason Sudeikis... Well, I'm trying... Oh, no, it's Ed Helms is Rusty.
Ed Helms is Rusty, yeah.
What is happening? This is a bad idea, isn't it? Oh, I keep losing Justin. I need him. He may, I'm scared. I need him to tell me everything's going to be okay. Oh, we lost him. Gosh, dang it. Freaking one day, Brian, 20 years from hence now, the internet will be so ubiquitous. You'll have a connection no matter where you're at. But for
that's
today,
right. And we won't have to worry about Skype. It'll just be always on.
Yeah. And in a city like San Francisco, where there's so much connectivity or so much innovation happening, you'd think their connectivity would be better. Damn it.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So hold on. Let's look at this. Ed Helms, Rusty Griswold.
Right. Leslie Mann is Audrey.
Okay. Hold on. Leslie Mann. I got to remind me. Oh, okay. I like her.
She's wife of...
continuing the tradition of having Audrey and Rusty never be the same person twice.
Right.
They do it yet again.
Yeah, Judd Apatow's wife is Audrey.
Yeah, Keegan, who's that Keegan and Keel dude, or his name is, the comedian dude, he's in it. Ed Helms, Nick Kroll.
I don't know who. Oh, gotcha. No, Key and Peele,
that's it.
Yeah, yeah.
He's in it. And Charlie Day's in it. Also, Justin's in it then. Justin Robert Young is in it. He didn't tell
great.
Us.
It does not say who Charlie Day is playing.
He's playing. Yeah, it doesn't say, does it?
Who is the cousin? Randy Quaid's
Randy Quaid's
son.
Cousin? Oh. He has a son in here?
Well, no, Randy Quaid had a son in the first Vacation movie.
Right, but is that happening in this movie?
I could see that happening. Because there's a Debbie Griswold and an Ellen Griswold. Well, Ellen Griswold was the wife, but
look, if you can't get him out of Canada and back doing this, there's a problem.
This is not going to be a vacation movie if there's no Randy Quaid, is what you're saying.
So, Justin, you're back.
You are not going to have a vacation movie. Nobody's putting Randy Quaid in any more movies.
Yeah.
The only movies Randy Quaid is making are the possibly pornographic ones he's making with his wife.
Yeah, this is true. Wow, I didn't know this was being made. I'm just kind of
stick it to Tom Hanks now.
I'm just a little freaked out about this. I don't know why, but anyway, directed and written by John Francis Daly. So look forward to that coming soon.
Yeah, I don't know. Hopefully they'll make it and they'll try to make a universe out of it and it'll be great. We'll all get spinoff movies.
Yeah, I mean, part of me okay, if you've got Chevy Chase and Beverly D'Angelo in it, and they are in it, I don't know what strength they're in it. How much of them we'll see, but if you can keep them in it enough to make that connection, then maybe you've got something here. But Cousin Eddie's kind of a big deal, you know?
Yeah.
And you can't swap him out like Rusty. It's not like he can
was
just keep
he,
making
he
a new Rusty.
He wasn't in European Vacation, though, was he? I know he didn't go to Europe with the family, but I wonder if he was in any sort of like...
good point. But
like
that was
a cutaway.
That's
like
a good point.
Back home or something.
But wasn't that the worst Vacation movie? Think about it that way, see?
Yeah, that was the worst Vacation
movie. And so maybe, just maybe, it's because he was.
Tell you what,
there.
Vegas Vacation, kind of underrated.
I agree,
yeah.
Papa Giorgio, dude.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. No, it was pretty good.
Yeah, and it had the... What's his name in there is always good. I forgot his name.
Wayne Newton?
Nope. Godfather, the Las Vegas show.
James Caan,
that's it.
He was in that?
Mm-hmm. He's the one that got Papa Giorgio his sweet jacket and brought him to all the poker high-end poker parties and all that stuff.
Right. Yeah, no listing of Randy Quaid for European Vacation. Okay. But it did feature William Zabka from Sweep the Leg, Johnny.
Yeah. Nice. Yeah. All right, here. I got a real quick question.
All right, go.
So we were talking a little bit about Eddie Murphy last week. We talked a lot about Eddie Murphy on the last jury show, talking about SNL 40. But he gets a lot of crap, right? And I'm not saying he doesn't deserve it or does deserve it, however your take on it is, for being somebody who used to be great at stand-up, now no longer does stand-up.
Mm-hmm.
And... makes a bunch of crappy movies and isn't as funny as he used to be.
Sure.
Right.
You know who else that could pretty much describe.
Oh, I'd love to. I'm stoked to hear
Jerry
this.
Chase? Yeah.
Well, he never did stand up.
No, right? That's true, right.
And also, he's like one of, like, he's apparently like a Pantheon, Mount Rushmore level butthole.
Yeah.
Right. Chevy Chase.
Yes.
Yeah. Like, Steve Martin.
Oh, yeah. Interesting.
Yet we don't really give Steve Martin as much crap as Eddie Murphy. Now,
watch out for that truck backing up, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a construction site next to the leather bar that is on the way to my my work here. True.
Stopping
things.
In for a quick one.
Yeah, they have a great chicken salad there. So.
Well, no. This is just the gay bar. The leather bar is actually right by the office. This is the stud.
Oh, gotcha.
You know, and then
motorcycles parked in front.
Yeah.
And then there's another leather bar that oftentimes flies flags that I need to Google to find out what is going on. Like, there was once where it was just like a big paw.
Yeah.
And I'm like, oh, good God, is that like, and then I Googled it and it was furries.
Oh,
it wasn't furries, it was bears.
That's bears. Yeah.
Yeah, bears. Yeah. It was a big bear, a gathering of the bears.
Yeah.
Like the gathering of the Juggalos, but with less grease paint.
Yeah, that's a good point. And more Faygo, or less Faygo? I don't know.
Less Faygo.
Okay.
Unless that's a slur of some sort. In that case, you're unwelcome here. In San Francisco, we're a tolerance.
Yeah, my accountant's name is Less Faygo. But anyway, go ahead.
So why do we give, why doesn't Steve Martin get the, you're not funny, do stand up?
I think it's because...
Because of Bowfinger. Well, I guess they were both in Bowfinger.
They were both in Bowfinger.
Boom, see?
Yeah.
Think that. And then you just got Bowfinger, bro.
I just got Bowfingered.
I loved Bowfinger. I thought that was a great movie.
Also, Eddie Murphy was nominated for Best Supporting Actor more recently than Steve Martin. In fact, mm-hmm. I don't know if Steve Martin ever has been.
He was nominated for Grand Canyon, wasn't he? Or something?
What was that one? Not Accidental Tourist. It was a Steve Martin serious thing like 5 years ago. I'm looking it up because I've got to remember what this thing is.
Steve Martin, actor, never to have been nominated.
Wow.
Yeah. So his chance really came and went with The Jerk, honestly. That was his big chance. I don't know what it is. I think part of it is maybe, and maybe some of this is artificial and made up.
Oh, the
but
Spanish
maybe,
Prisoner is what I'm thinking of, and that
oh,
was
Spanish
almost 10
Prisoner,
years ago.
Right, jeez. That's the one that he would have been, because that I remember people raving about his thing.
Yeah,
I never
that
saw
was the one that exactly.
But okay, so here, but to answer your question, here's what I think the difference is. Eddie Murphy, yeah. At least painted in the media, Eddie Murphy was painted as a big jerk behind the scenes, hard to work with. A womanizer, jumping from lady to lady, blah, 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 all this kind of weird stuff behind the scenes. And Steve Martin's never had that levied against him. Now, I'm not saying that was fair or even accurate, but I think,
yeah.
I feel like that was what was done, you know? And nobody ever
well,
talked about
Eddie
Steve
Murphy
Martin.
Eddie Murphy certainly was a bigger celebrity at his height.
Oh, for sure.
Than Steve Martin, right?
Mm-hmm.
He is probably a bigger celebrity now.
Yeah.
You know? Like, even so many years on. I guess, is it just that? Like, is it the fact that Eddie Murphy has a tabloid history where Steve Martin doesn't really? Mm. You know, I mean, what's the worst thing we know about Steve Martin? Like, his divorce wasn't, you know, like, it was a divorce where people had hurt, like, feelings? Like,
mm-hmm. I think that may have been it, honestly. Mm. He's, you know, stuff. Some of the stuff he talks about in his books, he's the one talking about and being open about.
Yeah.
By the way, he's 69. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. Holy crap. Yeah, right? he looks great for 69. Jeez.
Wait, which one? Murphy or
Steve Martin?
Steve Martin.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Steve Martin looks fantastic.
Yeah.
They both look great. I mean, I don't know. I guess it's just something that I've been kind of wondering about. You know, like, because I guess Steve Martin is more willing now. And so I asked this on Twitter, and I got back a lot of, like, Steve Martin reminds us why we love him more.
Mm.
But it's like,
that's interesting.
Is that where we are? Like, we need to keep, people need to keep reminding you why they love you, or else, like, we will, like, you are always in... a point of you know of retrograde.
Well, he's like
you need to keep pushing it up and up and up.
I feel like Steve Martin for years though has been so affable and willing. He'll show up on your late show with David Letterman and do a bit, even though there's nothing to promote or pimp. He'll tweet people and reply to real people. He uses Twitter and social media. So as we have rolled into this new era, he has been willing to do that. Eddie Murphy has not been willing to do any of that stuff. No talk shows, nothing. He doesn't want to do it.
Sure. But, like, so that's necessary?
No, I know where you're headed, and I agree with you 100%. It shouldn't be necessary, and in fact, isn't necessary. But if the question is, why do people feel somehow incensed, that's why.
But that would seem to indicate that it is indeed necessary. You know, it is something that if you want to be thought of fondly, you always have to be putting in maintenance. And also, but then again, like, so that there's like no celebrity that we just remember fondly as those people who did that thing and went away.
Well,
I mean, like Gene Wilder doesn't have to come out and remind us why he's awesome.
Right.
No, he does not. But here's my thinking. Here's a less life lesson that I believe in. If suddenly right now, this very second, somebody came to the door with a gun, an automatic gun, and was going to break into my house and shoot me and my family up.
Okay.
Suddenly.
And then asked you, who's funnier, Eddie Murphy or Steve Martin?
No. Let's say he was like unaware of my current thought experiment here. And he busted in and his sole purpose was just to cause mayhem in my small sphere. And suddenly, none of that would matter to me. Suddenly, who cares about Steve Martin, Eddie Murphy, and any other celebrity I've ever talked about? All that would matter is, are my kids safe? Where's Kim? What are we going to do? Right? Now, I know it's a little extreme, but my point is that it doesn't matter in the end, even if we think it does. It really doesn't. In the long struggle to live your life and be a good person and do what you got to do, in the end, it won't matter. We may have thought more fondly of Steve Martin, a guy we'll never meet, a guy we'll never meet in person, a guy whose hand I'll never shake, and I think a little bit less of Eddie Murphy, a man I'll never meet and never shake a hand or have a personal relationship with. And what the hell was that good for anyway in the end? That's all I'm saying.
Well, wait a minute.
Somebody puts a gun to your head to make you choose. You're taking that like different direction.
No. Nobody's taking.
The gunman didn't even make him choose.
No, that's my point. The gunman has nothing to do with it. Yeah, the gunman's not making me choose anything. I didn't say that. I'm saying he just showed up and threatened my life. Yeah.
At the point of death of you and your family, you won't care about Steve Martin and Eddie Murphy anymore.
That's my point. But
were we debating that?
No.
I will take to my grave
my point is. Hold on. My point is, I realize it's extreme. It's an extreme example. I'm known for those. But what I'm saying is, it doesn't matter. Because your question was, does it? It doesn't. It doesn't matter. Unless...
No. I mean, I don't mean like in terms of like the cosmic reflection of life or anything. Like, I just mean like, is it necessary for us to finally, for people who care about entertainment and who love comedy, let's just say, is there... You know, what is that line of where do we need to maintain, where does somebody need to maintain themselves, you know, to be thought of fondly? Like, and this goes for us, for everybody that's on this podcast right now and everybody listening. Like, if we stop doing the podcast, would we need to pop up on other podcasts periodically to remind people that we were well-liked? Or if they really, really liked us, would they be like, boo! I don't care about your art anymore. Do more Morning Stream. It's the only reason I cared about you.
Well, in the slightly larger scheme of things, eventually it all just drains out anyway.
Eventually we're all shot by gunmen.
Well, not that, but like,
force us to pause for reflection.
Nobody cares. Listen, nobody cares about Fatty Arbuckle today. Nobody. Name a kid who even knows who that is. I barely know who that might have been.
I often use Fatty Arbuckle as like a funny reference for like whenever I want to say something's really old.
Right, but there's nobody
that,
is...
That and Fibber McGee and Molly.
Sure.
Those are my two favorite old references.
I like those too, and I like that radio show. But the you know, those things were so relevant at the time. It's like once in a while you'll see like these in memoriam things, memorial deals that they do at the Oscars, and you'll see a face of somebody who... was really big in the 30s or 40s, and they're just finally shaking off their mortal coil.
Yeah.
No connection, no reference. But in their day, dude, the draw was insane. They just came from all around. So one day, 50 years hence, Eddie Murphy will be a blip on nobody's radar. and neither will Steve Martin. And I'm not saying that's good or bad or whatever. It's just the cycle. And I think it's important to embrace the cycle at some point, because otherwise, well, if you're a believer, one day you're going to be disappointed.
But I guess my point is not that they will fade into irrelevance, because I think absolutely, like, that certainly, you know, is always happening. You are always in retrograde from relevance, because that's fickle. You know, mm-hmm. the gaze of our popular culture darts quickly. Mm-hmm. However, there seems to be more than that with Eddie. There's like an anger with Eddie. There is a unfulfilled promise with Eddie that kind of seeps up, and we just kind of got another full bucket of last week after the SNL 40 thing, when he didn't do a bit and he just came out and his intro was longer than what he said. And although he seemed sincere and nice, it was like, no, we don't want you to be sincere and nice guy. Mm-hmm. We want you to be the funniest man on the planet.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he didn't do that. I mean, he did, you know, you could still argue, like, Chris Rock wasn't wrong. Like, his an enormous impact.
I mean, but
you
it's
know.
All about, I guess, and listen, they did themselves, you know, SNL did him no favors in giving him this, like, big, like, bam, 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 like, one of the funniest stand-ups of his own time, Chris Rock, giving, like, this full gigantic tribute.
Introduction, yeah.
You know, to right. Eddie Murphy, and then Eddie Murphy comes out and is like, hey, I'm here. And then that's it.
Then go to commercial.
Back. Let's go to commercial.
Yeah, yeah. That's weird.
But I don't know. I guess, like, the Steve Martin Eddie Murphy comparison was something that I hadn't thought of until, like, late last night.
Yeah.
And
huge
wonder
impacts.
Why.
It's huge impacts, both those guys. Also, if you look at pictures of Eddie Murphy on this is a totally non-scientific study, but I just did a Google image search for both men. Steve Martin is smiling in everything. Eddie Murphy is scowling in most everything.
Really?
Yeah. Now, it could be a small subconscious thing, but a lot of him just looking smirky and like he really doesn't want to be there. And maybe he doesn't. And who's to blame the guy? That's a lot of hot spotlight
well,
for a long time.
Well, he also experienced fame in a way that was way different than Steve Martin, mm-hmm. you know? Like, being that level of famous... Which, I mean, did you guys hear the reason why we did a whole jury kind of breakdown on the last podcast was because of Norm MacDonald's tweets?
Yeah, his tweets about Eddie Murphy and the Bill Cosby.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Bit. Yeah.
And my theory on why he doesn't want to do that was because, and maybe the reason why he, like, you know, just wanted to say hi and didn't want to be really funny on this gigantic stage, is I would read into it that he just doesn't want to have that level of fame again, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. or it scares him mm-hmm. on some level, you know, or it is undesirable. It's something that you would not want to invite back into your house once you have almost pretty much had it out.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, you know who it's like. It's like,
that gunman that burst into your house and made you reflect on life?
No, what's his name? The other comedian who quit Comedy Central and ran off.
Dave Chappelle.
It's like mm-hmm. that. I feel like Dave Chappelle has a lot of that sort of... So here's the thing that maybe happens. Steve Martin never shied away from Hollywood. He just became less of a draw or less of a reason to hire him, or he aged out of roles he would normally have, or got tired and changed what he would like to do or whatever. But he never seemed like he was actively avoiding the spotlight. But these are guys who seem like they're actively avoiding it, and that makes us all real curious about why, and we start jumping to conclusions why, and everybody wants to know what the hell's going on, and so they just end up creating actually a bigger circus around them because they are avoiding the circus.
Do they? I mean, like, Tom Hanks avoids a lot of stuff. Like, he still does, you know, stuff a lot, but he's choosy about stuff. Gene Wilder, like, has famously completely stopped doing everything and, like, rejects every script, you know.
Well, I'm not saying there's race. I'm not saying race has to have anything to do with it. But do you want? Do you
Whoa,
think? It,
I didn't say anything about.
No,
race.
No. I know, but that's what I'm asking. That's what I'm asking. Do you think it's possible that has any impact here? Because the two examples we use are black guys and the rest are white. You know.
I mean, here's all I'll say, And I think that no doubt it has something to do with it, but I don't, it, not in the way that I think people might initially think of, like, oh, well, we hate black people, so that's why we give Eddie Murphy more crap.
I don't even mean that, but you know what I mean? But, like, some difference, something's there.
No, I think that there is something in Bill Cosby and Eddie Murphy, in that moment in time, they, part of what made them gigantic, from big stars to icons, was that there, in a mass media level, these were black, you know, Bill Cosby was your black dad and Eddie Murphy was your black best friend.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was the funniest person in the world, you know, in a way that was more relatable than Richard Pryor. And certainly more than other contemporaries in that kind of genre, like Paul Mooney or something like that.
Sure. Yeah. Somebody the other day was saying on some podcast or something, they were talking about tragic ends to the lives of comedians too early. Suicide, drug overdoses, these kinds of things.
Yeah.
And the one guy, it was really revealing. One guy had assumed, and a question was asked to him live on a radio show where he had no, you know, no prior thought or whatever, but he basically popped out thinking, well, it's much, there are much more, many more tragic stories of the end of early lives with black comedians than there ever is with white comedians. And as it turns out, both statistically and realistically, it's the complete opposite.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Completely the opposite. There's so many white guys who have ended their lives or OD'd or
think of Phil Hartman or Kinison.
He had his life
John Lovitz
for him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
John Lovitz. You know he's still living, right?
Yeah.
I was making sure.
Well, no, that was
the running joke.
Oh, I missed that. What was the joke?
Well, they kept like talking about everybody that they missed and had lost and everything, and you know, they kept like the punchline was John Lovitz, and then including like the big super serious in memoriam. I was listening to a podcast with Seth Meyers, and Seth Meyers said that when they were running that, they showed the in memoriams to a few people beforehand, and two or three people, including Chris Rock, were watching it, and in the middle of it, not having seen it before, like turned to the guy editing it and said, "You should end this with Lovitz."
That's hilarious.
That's awesome. And then they cut to him in the audience, and he's shrugging his shoulders, looking around like, "What?"
No, that's funny. That's a great way to do that. I missed all. I didn't see the entire run.
It's just funny because he's been that joke for like 30 years, right? Like for as long as he has existed, everybody wants to like just crap on him as like, you know, remember that guy?
Yeah.
Like,
right.
But even like regular old stand-ups, like who was the guy that was a bit like Stephen Wright? I always forget his name. Mitch Hedberg's a big one. A couple of recent.
He was an OD, right?
He OD'd.
Was he a suicide or an OD?
OD, yeah. Same as Kinison.
Kinison was an OD.
Farley was
Richard
an OD.
Richard Jenny was a suicide.
Yep. Just a few years ago, in fact. Mm-hmm. So yeah, you have these.
Oh no, that's like 10. That's 10.
Has it been that long?
Was it really that long? Wow.
Oh yeah.
I don't remember
Platypus
that.
Platypus Man.
Is it Richard
Jenny?
Yeah.
I mean, that was like an original show on UPN. Show you how old that was.
Yeah, right. Wow.
Oh, you know what? That is Richard Jenny. I'm thinking of somebody else. I'm thinking of a more recent guy, and I can't remember his name, but another famous comedian or semi-famous comedian. Anyway, they just, if you want to talk about the drug problems and suicide problems, it's never you know, Eddie Murphy or whoever else. You know,
I mean, there's more white comedians than black comedians.
Well, that's true. That's true. That makes a difference, I'm sure.
So theoretically, I mean, it would be an insane, epidemic if there were more black comedians that died. Although, I mean, like there are, listen, large scale fame, I think, drives everybody a little crazy.
Yeah.
You know, like Bill Murray said, as soon as you get famous, you have 2 years where it is like absolutely impossible for you to not be a butthole.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't correct it after 2 years, it becomes permanent.
Wow.
And I believe that was him in describing Chevy Chase.
I was just going to say, I wonder if he was describing his old pal.
No, they barely got into a fist fight. they do not like each other, Murray and Chevy Chase.
I don't think Chevy Chase was anyone's pal, it sounds like. Nobody was friendly with him.
No. He came on SNL during one of their big rebuilding years. The cast that was super young but had like speaking of the devil, Randy Quaid, Robert Downey Jr., Julie Louis-Dreyfus.
Yeah. That was a weird year.
And he spent the entire time mocking like the one gay cast member and Robert Downey Jr. for his dad being a hack director.
Oh, wow, really?
Yeah, and like asking if his dad was dead yet and stuff like that.
Why would you like, what?
He, again, like, he would, if he was a Hearthstone card, he would be a legendary 9-9 bundle.
Look at you all into the Hearthstone. Now throw out the Hearthstone references.
It's so terrible. I'm all in.
I love that. I absolutely love it because you're not one of those guys that gets a game and then just completely gets immersed into it the way you have with this. It's insane. No, it's amazing.
It's really, and also Ashley's into it, so it's like
that's cool.
And she was already doing a bunch of gaming on the side, but now that you're into this, I feel like gateway drug time. This is your entry.
I don't know. This is why I stayed out for so long, Scott.
Yeah.
Because I don't you know, it's like, oh no, come on, we can all do recreational heroin, and I'm like, I don't know, you guys. I don't know.
Brian, give it a year, he'll be raiding with us on Sunday nights. It'll be crazy. Wow. Yeah. Think of that idea.
Jeez.
Good lord.
Oh jeez. Although I'll tell you what, now there is a reason to go to BlizzCon.
Yeah, there is. You have a very specific reason to go to BlizzCon.
I would very much like to go to BlizzCon.
You should. We'll all hang out.
Jerry getting way more hooked on Overwatch when that business comes out.
Oh gosh, that's gonna be good. I don't know. I feel like the cerebral fix.
No. You want to know what has gotten me into Hearthstone is that it is playable over its iPad, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it's playable over airplane Wi-Fi.
Yeah, true.
There's not many things that airplane Wi-Fi is good for.
Mm-hmm.
But for Hearthstone, it works like a charm. It's good enough. You don't really need that much of a connection for it.
And you fly a lot, and you got to fill that time with something. And it can't all be audiobooks and porn.
I've been trying to not sleep on flights just so I can keep a little bit of a more of a normal schedule. Like I can be more tired when I go, in the different directions and everything.
Sure.
So, like, it's good for keeping me awake because it's like, ooh, look, I have permission to play 4 hours of Hearthstone.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. I love that you found this. This thing, and I hope it envelops you like it does everyone.
I did donate to the Patreon of the Angry Chicken podcast so I could join their tournament.
Oh,
so
good.
I'll be a member of their tournament, surely to get my butt whipped like so hard in the first, like whoever gets me in the first round, you're welcome.
That's an incredible thing. I'm going to have to pay a very close attention to that tournament now. I was already tangentially interested. I'm not going to compete, but I do want to watch it. And now,
why don't you compete?
Because I suck at that game.
Well, so do I.
I'm really bad, though.
Do you know how excited someone will be when they whip both of our monkey asses?
That's true. Yeah,
like it'll be a thrill.
Maybe
get in
I will.
On it. Come on.
I'm already on their Patreon. Why not? You just have to do that. It's like the ticket in, right?
Well, yeah, at the $5 level. So if you're one of those cheapskates who's not at the $5 level, then then you know you might have to call in a few favors. But I think the thing went out today. Actually, no, I'll just subvert their whole
The whole campaign in one shot. Yeah,
I'm just gonna send you the link so
Brilliant.
you can sign up.
All right.
The only problem is I don't know if you have to verify your decks now. Because I don't want to I'm still building stuff. So like, I don't know. I'm probably going to find something really awesome by the end.
I feel like I never have the right. I feel like I never have all the cards I want ever. So, I don't know how. Yeah, I guess I'll just take, give them whatever I got. I don't know. We'll figure that out.
There was a magical time. I was just in Austin and Brian and I were playing Arena and we had like just this muster for battle plus the quartermaster combo for the paladin.
Mm-hmm.
Oh man, we had people quit. Like round three twice. It was like this terrifying experience. It was such a rush. Wow.
It's weird hearing Jerry talk about this stuff.
I know, it really is.
Yeah. So weird.
Anyway. That's my life now.
That's amazing.
Goodbye, humanity.
Let's start an offshoot podcast that's not, let TAC handle all the high level play. Let's start a show that is just dorks who suck at that game.
I mean, dude, literally, if you say that out loud, you know the people will bug us for it forever.
We'll do a little Patreon unlock or something. We'll figure it out. Justin, what else is happening this week before we let you go? Anything cool?
Jury podcast. I forget what we're going to do this week. But last week we talked about SNL 40. If you liked what we talked about, then go ahead and talk more or listen to more about that and Night Attack tonight, although it's probably going to be late.
All right. Well, there you have it. It's Justin Robert Young. Have a fun time at your game today, and may all your connections be solid.
Bye.
Bye now. All right. Brian, we have time for a couple of quick calls.
Okay.
And I'm going to play them now. Here is one about the iPhone.
Hey, Scott and Brian. This is Isaac in Lubbock, Texas, calling for the morning stream. Just thought I'd give you a little update on your iPhone issue you were having the other day. So I work in a Apple authorized service provider, and we get the same issue coming in the store a bunch of times. You're getting your wife's phone calls, she's getting yours. There is a little feature under your FaceTime settings called iPhone cellular calls. If you have that switched on, you're actually going to receive phone calls whenever you're connected to Wi-Fi of the other person that you may have connected to your iCloud account. So just wanted to assure you and assure Kim that Terpster probably didn't see your wife naked. So, you know, have a great day. Love the show, though.
Yeah, it was audio.
Y'all have an awesome one. Thanks. Oh. Bye.
Okay. It was audio only, so we knew we were okay. We were okay. But yeah, the whole, that setting you can change, and now we're good, and it shouldn't be a problem in the future. But I like it when some, the phrase, I assure you Terpster did not see your wife naked, is a fantastic thing to say.
If only were said more often.
I know, right? all right, how about stunt TV episodes? So we talked about this some. Here's a call about it.
Hey, guys. This is Ryan from Michigan. And on the topic of TV shows that always do gimmick episodes, you never mentioned the Drew Carey Show, which did a lot of them. They did things like episodes that were all in improv, and there were episodes with all kinds of mistakes that you had to spot the mistakes, and they did a little segment where everybody was characters in The Sims. So there's another one that you guys didn't mention, but plug the Provo or something. I don't know. see you later.
Plug the Provo.
The whole thing where there was this crossover with Whose Line Is It Anyway, where they'd be doing a scene and all of a sudden they'd be taking things from the audience, like you're in a laundromat and you're Joe Piscopo or whatever, and they'd have to automatically throw into something like that.
And I forgot all about that. They were really good at that. And I have some update of information on the character of John Munch, who was played by Richard Belzer.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
He holds the record for the longest running character in television history.
Right.
Because he started out in the crime drama Homicide: Life on the Street, ran that entire series, and then, let's see, here we go. Law and Order spinoff, Law and Order Special Victims Unit, he joined that show as that character after their crossover. And then there's something else. The ninth season premiere. Let's see. I thought there was something else. Oh, Internal Affairs.
Hmm.
He was in that.
Okay.
And then later, isn't there another one? Okay, so he's been on television longer than Gunsmoke's Marshal Matt Dillon and that Fraser Crane from Cheers. Right? Yeah, Fraser Crane. So it goes. So I think the order now goes Munch, Dillon, Crane.
Crane and Lou Grant.
And then probably Lou Grant. Yeah.
Right.
That's a good point. Anyway, that's interesting.
Yeah.
How weird. And it's such a small, it's not like a thing you think about. Like, I don't know. It's not like a big splashy thing that he's that, but that's his record. So way to go, Richard Belzer. Speaking of old white comedians. All right, Brian, we're done. Cool. That's it. If you want to send us phone calls, you can. 801-471-0462. That's 801-471-0462. You can email us at themorningstream@gmail.com. On Twitter, find us at Coverville, at Scott Johnson, and at Morning Stream. It's tomorrow's Wednesday, so we'll do Wednesday stuff tomorrow. That'll be good.
Right. Yeah. Tom, Nicole, recommendals.
Mm-hmm. All those things.
You remember your recommendal category?
I don't remember.
Category?
What's the theme? Wasn't it just anything
free
goes?
Free for all.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah. So, yes, I do remember.
Just want to scare you a little bit.
Yeah. Free for all tomorrow. That'll be fun. Looking forward to it. All right. Let's leave with music. How about that?
All right. Okay. We can do that.
Mm-hmm.
How about something going out to Brent? Hey, Bebop and Rocksteady. I'm a fairly new listener, but I'm hoping you guys can help me out. February 23rd will be the third anniversary of the start of dating for me and my wife, Angel. I know it was yesterday. We had a lot of stuff, by the way, for the 23rd. I know the two requests today were for the 23rd. As my wife has been playing my old copy of Elite Beat Agents for the DS, I would love you guys to play a song from that game to commemorate the occasion. If you can't find a good cover of I Was Born to Love You by Queen, Freddie Mercury and Queen, then a cover of YMCA by the Village People or Makes No Difference by Sum 41 would also work, as those songs feature in her favorite stages from the game. I've never played this Elite Beat Agents, but it sounds great.
That's great.
Thanks for making me laugh on this podcast and on Film Sack. Signed, Brent.
Yeah, that is a good game, by the way.
I've got to check it out. So it's actually got real licensed music in
mm-hmm,
it?
It did. Wasn't it a... I thought it was a DS-only game, but is it somewhere else now? Like, I think it was...
They were talking about DS, so...
I think DS-only, so I'm not sure you could get it for anything modern now, but if you still have a DS hanging around, you could probably find a copy
of it. So it's like a dancing game, but you're using the control pad to do the dancing, right?
The stylus. So you... These little... It's kind of hard to explain, but like these big circles would come, and they would shut. And when they would shut... and match up with the circle they were shutting into, you had mm-hmm. to tap in time with the music and make sure you got a really good tap. Gosh. So to synchronize it. But then tons of them are going off all the time around these dancing agents.
Oh God!
So it had okay. two things going for it. One, the gameplay was pretty fun and addicting, but also the story and that ridiculous presentation was awesome. Because the way they would defeat their enemies was to dance. It was
interesting.
Ridiculous.
Well, I guess I could. It's three. It's a DS, so I could easily play it on my 3DS
yeah.
XL.
Yeah, it's great.
Certainly. Yeah. Cool. I'll have to check that out. Anyway, back to the music. How about a cover of I Was Born to Love You? This is a song that Freddie Mercury recorded solo, but Queen also recorded and released. It must have been posthumously on the Made in Heaven album as a bonus track on the Made in Heaven album. And a re-release of it, I should say. The version we're playing today is by a band called Too Close to See. It's from the Good Old Days EP. This is actually one that the requester wanted to hear.
Cool.
So, very cool. Too Close to See, Good Old Days EP. This is a Japanese punk band, and how could you not enjoy this?
Well, here it is. We'll be back tomorrow, right? Yeah, we'll see you guys tomorrow.